Hi everybody, my name's Antoinette, this is Good Owl Games, and welcome to August Monthly Roundup, the casual video where I talk to you about the changes to my board game collection. So saying Good Owl Games is still definitely weird. For those of you who don't know, I'm formerly Board Game Inquisition. Went through a name change about a month ago and I'm still adjusting. Don't look at my website. So much fixing to be done. But yeah, there's a lot of work that goes into changing your name. Although I definitely feel like this is a step in the right direction. But yeah, I don't know where time is going. I don't know about you guys, but do you feel like summer literally just disappeared in the blink of an eye? I don't know, I'm trying to make the most of it, but this month feels like a month where I had a lot of catching up to do. So I feel like I've been super busy trying to get through things. And because of that, it means I've played less of my own games this month. So yeah, for those of you unfamiliar with the format, firstly, I'll talk about new games to my collection. I used to talk about trades, but that's gone. And then the next section is where I talk about some games I've been playing over the past month. And then there's like a personal bit at the end if you want to hang out and just, I don't know, hear how I'm doing or what the channel's up to, kind of, you know, that kind of stuff. And I'll put timestamps in this video so you can hop around as you wish, although it would be cool if you just stayed and listened to me the whole time, but that is a large commitment. Okay, so we'll start with the new games, right? Because this is always exciting. And the reason actually I have a lot of new games this month is because of the travels I've been doing. So the previous month I was talking about holidays and I had some pictures and we'd gone places. And as some of you know, I am the sort of person who doesn't leave the house. So holidays was a big thing, but I've tried to keep it going. And what that means is that normally where like we would go for a spin to like the beaches or forest or stuff, it's all down in West Cork, which means we pass our favorite board game shop on the way. So we have acquired more games than normal simply by virtue of being close to the board game shop. So the first random purchase that comes from our spins is Meadow from Rebel Games. And this one looked attractive based on its cover. I hadn't heard or seen much about it on the internet. I believe it's just been released. And so this was kind of like an impulse purchase, is probably the best way to put it. And I have actually had a chance to play this one because it seems kind of light and cheery, and it absolutely is. So Meadow is a game about sightseeing in the sense that you are trying to see different things in your meadow. What this means in terms of card game, which is what it is it's a tableau builder. So you place pieces of scenery or stuff down in your meadow and they will have particular symbols. And to add more things to your meadow, they will require these symbols. But the problem is when you add something to your meadow, you're going to have to cover up the symbol on the card beneath it. They kind of stack on top of each other. So then you have different symbols now with which to kind of add more things to your vista, I want to call it. And so that really is the long and short of it, is that it's a tableau builder where you're covering up the symbols and then you need to use the symbols to acquire more things into your tableau. There are a couple of other touches to it than this. So for instance, there's a grid from which you purchase your cards, and you have a little kind of picket fence, a little arrow, and you can choose things from along the row or the column, kind of like an Excel spreadsheet. And I thought that's a nice touch too. Different cards are added depending on, you know, the duration of the game. They come from like different directions. There's north, south, east and west, isn't it? And the game plays for quite a long time. It's much longer than you would think a light game like this is. It took about 90 minutes for two of us to play this. It's very pleasant. It's very cutesy. The art is adorable and it was easy to kind of play, so we enjoyed it. It was very laid back. I wish it was a tad shorter than it is. So that's Meadow. So next up are two games newly acquired, but I have not played yet, so you're just gonna have to put up with that. But it was suggested to me that I should at least explain why I wanted these games. So I'll do my best for that. So the first one is, and I have to read it to make sure I have it right, Praga, Caput, Regni. I am sure that's butchering it. Most people know it as Praga. And this is a game from Vladimir Suchi, who you may know from all sorts of wonderful designs, such as Pulsar 2849. I'm never quite sure of that number. I just called it Pulsar. I believe his is Transatlantic or Shipyard. Look at me go. He's definitely done Last Will and a couple of other like big games, as in... What interests me about this title is the fact that I've played a lot of Vladimir Suchi's games and I really like their designs. We really enjoyed the first play of it. However, we have a very difficult time getting them back to the table after the first play. When I say I've played five or six of his designs, I'm not even joking. And we usually enjoy them. I just don't know why we find it difficult to want to replay them. So when we saw Praga, this is, from pictures anyway, it's a huge sprawling game. It's got a ton of setup and what involved, including a crane. I've seen a crane, is that right? For those of you who've played it. And I'm always attracted by what he makes. I always want to see what it's about, even though I have a feeling it may not necessarily be for us. So when I saw Praga for sale secondhand, I was like, this is my chance, people. Let's go for it. So I'm not sure how well we'll do with it, but this is why I want to play it. I do love a good big Euro game. I'm totally down with that. I've really enjoyed his previous designs. I just don't know how much staying power it has. So that should be interesting. The second game is interesting as well. I like using the word interesting. And this is Warhammer Quest, The Silver Tower. Do I have it right? Silver Tower, or is it Silver something else? No, I had it right. Silver Tower. I was calling it something slightly different. Now, so as some of you know, I've been painting miniatures a lot lately. I've also been playing some war games that were not Warhammer related. Because any of you who have dipped your toes into Warhammer before know it's an expensive hobby. And I've already got one of those with my board games. So I wouldn't allow myself to buy miniatures from Warhammer, you know, if I wasn't going to use them. I don't want to buy stuff I'm just going to paint and sit in a shelf. That's not who I am. But then I discovered that Warhammer make board games. And I was like, a board game, you say? With miniatures. And it's a board game. So you can see where this idea is born from. I've also never played any of the Warhammer Quest series. So this looks like a kind of dungeon crawler with a specific kind of, with the good guys, it's got the bad guys in the box, you know, and some terrain bits. So that's basically what I'm expecting out of this, but I mostly bought it to paint the miniatures. Although they're so tiny when they showed up, I was so surprised. But it is a board game that I can talk about, I can play, and I got miniatures. So this seems like a win-win to me. I will report back when I've played it to let you know, you know, if it was actually worth playing or not on top of everything else. Yeah, that should be interesting. But as you can see, the two games I've not played yet are the ones that require a bit of time and effort to play, so I haven't quite got there yet, especially Praga. I want to give Praga like a proper whole weekend day to, you know, devote to, as opposed to an afternoon. So those are the two new games, so you can see what I was thinking there. And I then have two review copies. So the first one to arrive, I'm going to get the title all in one go here, is The Red Burnoose, Algeria, 1857. There you go. It's got such a cool title, right? I think it's a really cool title. So this is a introductory war game that's coming to Kickstarter on September the 14th. And I'm creating a Kickstarter preview for this. And it's like, I play war games with miniatures. I don't often do it with chits and tokens. Never really been overly appealing, but this one is pretty darn cool, if I do say so myself. What this one is about is basically, it's the French are trying to take over these Algerian villages. They invaded Algeria already, but there are these villages hiding out in the mountains, you know, and they're basically gathering together to prevent the French from taking over. Firstly, it's interesting that you are not the colonizer in this war game. I like that a bunch. We were kind of the rebel scum. I also like that there are women leaders and, you know, and women play a part in this combat. There's a lady on the cover, and in fact the game is named the Red Burnoose after a famous lady who was part of this entire conflict. And I like that a lot. It's mostly a deck builder, and what your deck does, it influences the board with your troops and you move them around. It's cooperative, so that was fun as well. And overall, it's a really nicely and solid, like, put together game. I was quite impressed with it. So if you haven't thought about war games before and you're thinking maybe you'd like to, I would definitely check this out. Yeah, I had a lot of fun with it. So there you go, people. War games, just what we need more of, especially a different one like this. This one felt different. So there's that. So you can watch out for my review of that. And next up is one I latched onto because of the Irishness of it all. And of course, Irish people should lift other Irish people up. At least I believe so. So I don't know if you guys have noticed, but in the past, you know, I want to say decade, Irish animation has become kind of a bigger deal than normal. So we did like the Secret of Kells and stuff like that. There's a studio in Ireland called the Cartoon Saloon that have been creating all sorts of really awesome and interesting animations. And so when I heard there was a board game based on their latest offering, which is WolfWakers, I was like, what a great opportunity to talk about, you know, awesome Irishness and combine it with a board game. So basically this one seems to be a storytelling board game. I haven't got around to playing it yet. It's a small little thing. But I don't know. There was something about it that called to me. I think part of it is the Irishness, but I also like the idea of, I haven't played a storytelling game in some time, and I'm very curious to see how it will play out in cards. You know, how will this fit together? Because I often find storytelling games are very dependent upon who you're playing with and their ability to imagine and, you know, want to get on board with this whole story idea. I've not had much success with these before. I had Once Upon a Time, I think that was called, a long time ago now. I love the idea of telling stories. So yeah, I'm excited to see what this one has to unveil. So, you know, keep your eyes peeled, folks, there'll be more. So I think that is all of the new games. I'm gonna have a very quick check because you know me, I might forget. Nope, that is all of the new games. So yeah, we're kind of on the lighter side this month. And I still have not played some of the new games from last month, so you're going to have to like wait another month, but some of them will be now in the played section as usual. So this is how we do it. So what I talk about here should be in section 2 next time around. Yeah, all going good. So what have you been picking up? Has there been anything good coming out? Like, I'd love to know, actually, what do you guys think I should try? Or what do you think I should play? Because I'm at the point now where there's very few games we actually want to play or try anymore. And I wonder, am I missing out on some really great designs? So yeah, I'd love to compile a list from you, the viewer, of games you think I should look at. If I've already looked at them, I'll take note. Maybe that could be its own video in future, a list video of the games I should look at. And we could do that. All right, so we're going to motor on to the next section, which is games I've played. So I found it really interesting, actually, that after last month's video and your comments, that Beta Colony was the game that people wanted to hear more about, which is interesting, isn't it? I wonder if this is to do with it being kind of on sale, or at least at a bargain price. Maybe a number of you have picked it up and not gotten around to it yet. Well, I have played Beta Colony for you. It was not very fun. Okay, so what's Beta Colony about? Well, this is a game in which you're in space and you are attempting to terraform various planets, kind of. And how you do this is by placing out bases onto them. And the bases are of particular colors, so they match particular things. And the more of the colored bases you can connect up on your planet, the better. It's that kind of thing. It's played over a set number of rounds, and the actions you can perform on a turn are determined by rolling dice. So there are ways to mitigate your dice. You have fuel, so you can add a plus or minus one to your dice, but the options that you could do with the dice were severely lacking. You were basically either getting colors so that you could go by your bases, bases or doing the go buy your bases action, which combined with the terraforming the planet action. Yeah, we got bored real fast when we were just rolling the dice, but was always one or two actions we wanted to perform. It's possible this may be it's just a two player problem because, you know, we were kind of doing our own thing, but I think that main mechanic is lacking. At least for me, like maybe other people don't mind that as much as I do. But yeah, that really took the fun out of it. And I also felt like the game dragged quite a bit. It could have ended turns before it was supposed to. But yet again, this might be to do with the fact that it just wasn't fun to roll dice and land on the same spots every turn or every second turn. It's like, I want to go here, then I need to go here, then I want to go here, then I want to go here. So yeah, so that was my experience of Beta Colony. I wouldn't mind. It's a really good looking game when you open it up. What's really fun about it is trying to guess where all the different pieces have come from, because they clearly come from other games. So we were there trying to guess, like, that meeple is from whatchamacallit. I'm going to think of this. I know I am. Race for the Galaxy. And I was like, or is it from Roll? Because you got the little guy holding the thing. Yeah, there was stuff like that. So yeah, not fantastic. Sorry, I didn't come back with better news. The other game I need to talk about from last month is Heiki Strike Alternative. Get yourself ready, folks. So as pointed out last month, this is a game in which you have women dressed as weapons. Yes. So yeah, there's a girl dressed as a panzer tank. Why not? There's also a girl as an aircraft character, an aircraft carrier. Yeah, okay, there's a girl dressed as a gun. Okay, so that will or will not appeal to you, I don't know. Now, what I cared about actually was the gameplay itself. And so this is actually quite familiar and very well put together, might I add. So this is a game in which you are the Allied forces or the Axis forces in World War II. You have a bunch of units that are essentially different types of weapons. And what you're doing is you're kind of fighting over a piece of land or whatever in the middle of the board, and you're playing down these different vehicles. They have different kind of power values, strength values, and then whoever has the most after hitting a particular number gets to win the zone. And then it was kind of best of a number to see who wins. There are also spaces for winning at air superiority and land superiority, where your planes go and your ships go, which I thought was cool. Each card usually has its own ability when it comes into play, or it will trigger when something else happens and whatnot. And you know what? It reminded me a bit of Smash Up. So, you know, where you have the thing in the middle that you're trying to win contests over, and you're playing in these numbered cards till somebody gets there. It's like that, except for two player. I thought some of the abilities on the cards are quite smart. I like them a lot. I think this is actually a very polished game. I had a bit of fun with the art too. I just thought it was hilarious. I just couldn't stop laughing. It's like, my girl is a plane. Okay, fair enough. You know, there's just something really hilarious about it. There's also something unusual about the fact that women are weapons. Like, I kind of like that as an idea. You know, they're not just sitting around looking pretty. These are fighting for you on your side as a weapon. So yeah, I think this is something that you're either going to love or hate. It's a little bit Marmite, but the game itself is pretty sound. So there'll be a review for that following soon, that I've at least got to take it out of the box and try it. It's been a busy month, so more plays and things to come soon. So those were the two games from last month that were new that I didn't get a chance to talk about yet. I'm sorry, you're going to have to wait another month for Raiders of the North Sea, because I still haven't got to that box. That's on the agenda. Now, when it comes to some other games that I've been playing, I've managed to play games with other people, which is pretty special, meaning I have access to games I wouldn't normally buy or have access to. So last month I spoke about Halorato. Yeah, apparently I couldn't pronounce it right. This month I want to talk about Pax Pamir. So Pax Pamir is a game in which you are in tribes. So it's set like couple of hundred years ago, I think now. And what's happening is that you've got all these external powers coming in, such as the Russians and the British, who are basically trying to take control of the tribes or change loyalties with different tribes. And that really is what the game is about. It's about controlling areas of the map and making sure you are on the winning side at the right time. It's a card game at its core, so you'll have, you know, to be able to do anything on the board, you will require cards to do so. You can send out spies and things to other countries. The way I understood it best was I wanted to put discs on the map, which were my tribes, and then also those beautiful standy uppy tokens as armies. And I don't know how to explain how this is so good, but I think it was the moment I realized. So I started out and I was like, I'll be the British because I'm pink, right? So I'm going to be the British and I'll play British cards and things so that, you know, you stay British. And everyone else went off and did their own stuff. And as you place things out on the board, the supply empties, you know, for your armies and things like that. And that matters for scoring. There's a phase that will happen, like a dominance phase, and it will check if somebody is particularly far ahead in some aspect or another. And if they are, they'll get points, or they might even win, which has happened as well. So I was doing my British thing. I was being really cool. And both my other Bryans were doing their own things. And then I got to a point where I realized that, so we're going to score the thing soon. And I'm like, I could just play a card that would make me not be British anymore, but I would be Afghani. And they're winning right now. So I could be part of the winning side. And that's, I think, the most amazing part of this game, the fact that you can switch your allegiances. And because they're related to these tokens, so, you know, the Brits were pink, but if I swapped Afghani, they're yellow. And I'm like, so all of a sudden I can use all the yellow things that are on the board as my own. I think this is amazing. I think this is a brilliant, brilliant concept. And I had so much fun with it. I'm gutted in a way that I don't think it'll play well with two players. This is definitely one of those, like, you need three people really when you're fighting over any map, right? I think so, because otherwise at two it could just become a bit of a, I do this, you do this, you know, there's none of that interaction-y stuff. Otherwise I think I would love to own this. I think this was such a fun game, so much so that we played it the next night he came to visit. And I just, there's something about that switch of power that is just so smart. I've never seen it in anything else. So I have absolutely loved my time with Pax Pamir, despite the fact, like, it's a historical game. It doesn't really feel like that. I don't think you really need to follow the history all that much. It does feel an abstract strategy, although there are some very cool named people and places and stuff that you can, you know, pick up bits and bobs about as well, that I liked very much. Yeah, overall it's a great production of a game, and one I really, really, really liked. So yeah, so that is Pax Pamir. Right, so the final game I'll talk about is an oldie but a goodie, because I like to try and bring one of these in every month. And this is Terraforming Mars. Terraforming Mars has been in my house a really long time, and it is my husband's favourite game. And we pulled it out during the week just to play it for, you know, because it had been a while. And for those of you who are familiar with Terraforming Mars, yes, it's a game about terraforming Mars. I've made that joke ever since I made my first review about it, if you want to go check that out. God, that's back in not my heyday. So please don't look at that. But yeah, it's a game where you are a big corporation and you are trying to earn lots of money so you can terraform Mars and make it habitable. Habitable, there we go. And this is done through a big pile of delicious, delicious cards. And all of the cards will do different things or whatever that will affect the planet or will affect your production values. And all of these things are all bundled into cards somewhere. And we've always loved the game, I think simply because you could choose to ignore terraforming the planet, because that's how the game ends, you know, once the planet has got to a particular oxygen value or a particular temperature. But you could just play cards. And that is normally how we play this game, because the cards are so much fun. And I sat playing it during the week and I was like, why do we like this game so much? Like, I often slate games for being so random, you know, oh, you just pull a card off the top and whatever. But for some reason, I don't think that's the case with Terraforming Mars. And I think it's because every card matters. It can do its own thing. And they have in some cases, like multiple functions. You can always sell your card for money if you want, or things like that. But there's just something about the fact that each card is its own unique entity that makes it interesting. And yeah, I guess that makes it a bit more than random. Of course, we have to talk about the art, because it's one of my favorite features of the game, and I'm probably alone in thinking this. But I have always made the argument that the art in Terraforming Mars fits the game. If you look at it, you're familiar with it, it looks like clip art. It looks like just someone got a bunch of free art pieces and slapped them on the cards. And I think that fits so well for the type of thing you are doing as a corporation out in the middle of nowhere in a cheap ass world. And I always think that matches the feeling of the game, where everything is bland and organized and like staged. So yeah, so I will always have a fondness, and every so often we'll dig out a card and I'll be like, this is hilarious, who put this card with this, like with this picture. Like, yeah, it's not pretty in the traditional sense, but I do find it entertaining. So that's Terraforming Mars. Does anyone else here love it as much as we do? And what do you think about all the expansions? Because it is a game with about 10,000,000 expansions. I'm pretty sure we actually have all of the expansions, but we don't play with all of them. I think we play with Prelude, because it's the one that allows you to kind of start the game faster. You get kind of bonus cards at the start and things like that. I don't think we've played much with the newest one at all. Do you have a favorite set of expansions to play with it, or those you would favor over others? I'd like to know. Maybe there's another way to play Terraforming Mars I haven't approached yet. Are you the type of person who just draws all the cards, or do you focus on the planet? It'll tell me a lot about you, actually, depending on your answer. So I'd love to hear how you feel about Terraforming Mars and anything else I've mentioned, actually. So what have you been getting to your table this month? I love, love, love hearing this bit. I definitely want to hear about what you've been up to. So we're going to go on to the final section, and I'm not sure what I'm going to tell you, but we'll figure it out, I suppose, when I get there. And I'm pretty sure I made the same joke last month. I really need to, like, freshen this up a bit. Okay, hold on, folks. Be right there. So this is feeling like the month of 50 million catch-ups, because it started with the rest of my holidays, and I was sick for a week. And then kind of everything has kind of piled up in repercussions, because, you know, you can't edit stuff or post on the internet until you make it first. So there's been a bit of a backlog going on, you'll have noticed, I suppose, in the lack of videos going out. But that is being remedied. I've been working my ass off the last week or so trying to get things back in some sort of semblance of order. I feel like I should be apologizing for not putting something out all the time. But I have to be reminded, how few kind of spoons I have and how much I do. I'm not going to lie, it's hard watching other people being able to put out so much content, being able to do so many things, especially, you know, when a new game comes out and you can see people making content for it almost immediately. I'm like, wow, I have such a process to go through to get to everything, you know, and it's not a quick one. I'm not at the same kind of level as everybody else. And I'm not necessarily jealous of that, but it's just, I suppose you can't help but feel a little bit put in your place by just kind of, you know, you know what it is? There are just so many amazing people making amazing things. Like, wow. Have you ever just searched for a particular board game, found a channel you didn't know existed, and there were these, you know, amazing people doing stuff? I'm always completely dumbfounded by, you know, kind of the quality and the amount of effort that people put into making things. And I'm trying to learn to be content with the fact that I'm not going to be at the same level as everybody else, no matter how much I might want to. I don't have the energy for that. Like, I had a great idea for a painting video last night, and I was like, I'll never get to make that. I'll never have the energy to do that. And so I have to keep plowing on in my very small portions, when I wish I could do more. And I think accepting that this is it is a very difficult thing, because, you know, as a people, we're always strive to try better, do more, you know, make, you know, improve upon things. And I don't know where you're supposed to go when you can't go up. Does that make sense? Like, when you're just going sideways. And that's what it feels like a little bit around here. I like, I have a lot of things I would like to do or try to do, and I just can't get there. It's just too far. And so I'm trundling along as I am, I suppose. And thank you for being here with me. So lots of catching up, check. Good news is, I suppose, on a more personal front, I don't know if it's good news or not, but I've been trying to keep doing the outdoors thing. So that's been hard work for all sorts of stupid reasons that maybe you'll laugh at me about, but that's just how it is. But I've been trying to get out for walks every day, or we like to go kind of get in the car and go for like a hill walk somewhere, or go to the beach or something. And that's a huge amount of effort on my part. Like, I have to sleep for days after leaving the house for a while. And it's tough, but I know it's the right thing to do, right? We all know that, but the right thing isn't always the easiest thing, is it? I've at least been enjoying our spins out and, you know, buying some board games and things like that. But I find it hard then to come back to the inside world and be content with this when there's all of that out there. I'm not sure I'm really making a bunch of sense anymore, but, you know, that's where we go. I wish I got to play more games this month. I'm finding it kind of hard that there are games, I've new games here that I've not played yet. And part of that is because, yeah, I'm a bit behind with my review stuff, but also I got really bogged down on a particular review. And I spent weeks playing that game to ensure that I could talk about it. So this is Imperium Classics. My video went out for that last week if you want to have a look at that, but it was a really tough review to make, and I was never confident that I was able to talk about it coherently so I would play it more. So it bogged down a ton of my time in what I hope though is like a helpful review at the end of the day. That's the important bit, but it also just shows that I'm asking a lot of myself at the moment. So that's where it goes. So otherwise, still been painting minis, so yeah, that's been happening. Still playing a little bit of the old War Machine when I get the chance. I'd love to know what other games you play that aren't just board games, if any. That includes video games, actually. Has there been anything fun there? And I'm looking to kind of getting into more board games, which is surprising. The other thing I really want to do this month, because I'm making a promise to myself here, it's like, well, next month. So this month, I really want to rejig our games room round a bit. I saw an amazing photo on one of the board game groups of someone else's games room, and I was like, God, that looks gorgeous. And I'm like, why can't our games room look like that? And I'm not sure if there's a reason it can't. So, like, when I say we've a games room, I basically mean we give up a spare room in our house so that we can have a room to play games in. Because that's really, really us. And I was just like, why can't it look like that? So I really want to jig it around a bit and make it a bit more personal and nice. You know, you want your games room to be kind of nice. Like, it's never going to be, I've got a fridge and, like, you know, a coffee station nice, but maybe I could make it so that, you know, it's at least comfy and stuff. So that's my goal for the month. Maybe I'll come back with pictures and tell you what I did to my games room. But yeah, I suppose, like, where do you play games? That's what I want to know. Like, I'm lucky there's only the two of us here in our three-bedroomed house, so we can afford to kind of donate a room to a games room. I know not everybody has that luxury. Like, I want to hear from the people who play at the kitchen tables, because that's where the real gaming happens. Where do you play your games? Right, speaking of playing games, I'm going to go try and play some more, and I'll come back next month, hopefully, with even more information. I don't know how I'm going to keep this whole new board game influx happening when there's nothing much to buy, but I will tell you about what I've been playing, because that's what this is all about. So until next month, thank you for tuning in. Make sure to like and subscribe if you haven't done already, because I assume you all know by now that's kind of important to me, and would be very, very helpful. And until next time, tune in again for more not reviews, for more chit chat. Yes, board game chit chat. All right, everybody, take care. Bye bye.